Russ Newdorf. We'll be talking first on climate change effects on infrastructure. It's okay to stand. How are we typically doing this? Does it matter?
Whatever is comfortable. There's a microphone, there's a clicker.
Okay, well,
there's all sorts of technology.
You tell me, you can tell me if I need a microphone.
Sure.
I hope that's not the case.
I think we should.
I've worked at the Department of Transportation for quite a number of years. In the last even almost longer than that, I've been as deputy minister, but there's been a recent transition in the department. We combine ourselves with the Department of Public Works and Services, and we now have a Department of Infrastructure. So I am a special project advisor. I'll be there for the next half a year or so. But I will be talking from a transportation perspective. That's the background I know about transportation infrastructure, and particularly with climate change and the effect that that's been having on our infrastructure. And so I'll talk from that perspective, a very kind of a practical on the ground, here's what we're seeing, here's what we're doing about it. And then Steve will give you the little more of a scientific perspective on our approach to that, studying the problem, et cetera. And this is supposed to take about 15 minutes, I think, so keep to that. So first, I assume, I don't know, most of you are aware of the NWT infrastructure or not, but is everybody from Northwest Territories?
Mm-hmm.
Only one?
We've got a few.
Not?
No, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Well, so, very quickly. We have 2,200 kilometers of all-weather road, so for a size 1.2 million square kilometers, 3, quite limited all-weather road infrastructure. We do, on that all-weather road infrastructure, we have 4 ferries, summertime, ice bridges in the wintertime to provide that service. We augment the all-weather system in the wintertime by constructing 1,600 or just over 1,600 kilometers of winter road to connect additional communities, provide access for resource development. The department also operates 27 public airports, and then just in terms of the transportation system itself, there is a rail line that comes from Alberta, moves to Hay River. We have a multimodal facility in Hay River to offload from rail and onto barges, and then barges would move on Great Slave Lake down the McKenzie River and up into the High Arctic and points further. So that's kind of an overview of our transportation system. So when we talk about climate change, and from my perspective, we're talking about a few different things. It should be no surprise here, but obviously warming and average temperatures getting warmer, and we in the department needing to deal with that. But then the other issue, of course, is variability on both precipitation and on temperature. So might be some years where it's colder, years where it's warmer, less precipitation, more precipitation. Got to deal with the variability of weather. And so it's the two things. It's the getting warmer, and it's the variability in both the temperature and the precipitation that we're dealing with. The graph, just to, or the picture, sorry, is from 05-06, probably the warmest or the second warmest winter on record in the NWT. So the darker the color there, the higher the variation from normal for that year. You can see that one focus right around Great Slave Lake, in northern Alberta, Saskatchewan, and into the Yellowknife area, and then the other one up in the Beaufort Delta. This that winter, 05-06, caused a lot of issues for us to our seasonal infrastructure, our winter roads. So bad in the Beaufort Delta, I think it was still cold enough, even though it was 7 or 8 degrees warmer than average, to construct our ice roads and ice bridges. But around Yellowknife, there was a lot of problem. And the diamond mines in particular, there were their challenges. And so they ended up not being able to get to full loads ever through the season. Their season was cut much shorter than it had been. They ended up flying in all their freight, and their estimate was $100 million it cost them, to additional cost to resupply the mine. So a very real, a very significant cost for the diamond. And they've been adjusting their operations ever since to not have to spend that $100 million again. So when we look at infrastructure, different effects on different types of infrastructure. And so I've got winter roads, ice bridges, all-weather roads, next slides, airports, and ferry marine operations. So some of the things that we're seeing, and we have been noticing this for the last 15, 20 years now, that these changes kind of, we're weren't aware exactly what was happening, but knew we had problems and needed to address it early on. And then, of course, as climate change got to be more in the psyche of people and more awareness rose about it, we obviously realized that was happening and kind of focus our efforts around that. But winter roads, obviously you get warmer winters, you've got shorter and more variable seasons for the winter road operations. I've got a couple of graphs that'll illustrate that. You get more problematic ice conditions. Thinner ice is obviously the worst one, but you can have just doesn't freeze up like it should be, and then you get rubble ice, and so it makes construction a lot more challenging. And then if you do have more precipitation in the form of snow, that can insulate the land, it insulates the ice, so we have to deal with that. You don't grow ice or get the frost penetration into the ground as much as typically. On all weather roads, warming temperature affects permafrost degradation. Lots of evidence of that. Anybody that's driven out of Yellowknife going south, you'll notice the first 100 kilometers from here to Bechico has an area with discontinuous permafrost and lots of challenges there with temperature warming and even just the disturbance that the winter road caused to that permafrost and dealing with that. You get more warmer weather, you get more precipitation, you have more vegetation, so we have to deal with that. They're all going in. Challenges. Changing runoff characteristics around water. If it's drier, typically we like dry weather as an infrastructure department. The drier, the better. The infrastructure does not like moisture in general. So if it's dry, that's fine, but if it's wet, that's more of a challenge for us. So it manifests itself by, you could have a wet spring, so then your subgrade gets saturated and your road, you have to put weight restrictions on the road. You can have culverts don't have the required same capacity because you've got higher level of precipitation, so you can have culverts at capacity and roads overflowing, and then you're cut off for a period of time. Freezing rain and freeze thaw cycles, of course, are problematic both in winter roads and in airports. You see that on the next slide. So we have been adjusting our maintenance efforts for quite a while now, putting more chemicals on the road, more gravel, more sand and salt on the airports. And of course, freeze thaw cycles are also another enemy of infrastructure. More potholes, more maintenance efforts required. And then the variability in climate can lead to increased road closures. In the last 3 years, we've had quite dry summers, and so forest fires have been an issue, but it's been a big challenge for us to respond to forest fire situation with road closures, etc. And then culvert failures, I talked about before. On airports, again, permafrost degradation. If it's a gravel runway, it's relatively easy to maintain, fix it. You can fill in the gravel spot, grade it off. It's not a good condition. When it's a paved runway, it's much more problematic. So we have Yellowknife, Hay River, and Inuvik are three runways that have permafrost or subsidence issues of some kind. We're still trying to figure out what exactly it is. Freezing rain is never good for an aircraft, so it both affects us to operate the infrastructure and also air carriers that provide the service on that infrastructure. And then ferry and marine, I think what we're seeing there is a couple of things, a variability in the water level. 2 years ago, Mackenzie River quite low, and in fact, NTCL, who was operating barges at that time, couldn't get all their fuel delivered down the river, so some communities didn't get all the fuel they wanted. Luckily, it wasn't too big of an issue. There was enough fuel within the community, but could be a significant challenge because your way to respond again would be to fly that freight in until the winter road would get open. And then reduced Arctic sea ice, particularly up in the high Arctic islands. If you're like shipping through the Arctic, this could be a good thing because you have more reliability to get through the Arctic. And we're seeing that now with more cruise ships, more, 2 years ago, it was a cargo ship that transited the Arctic as well. And I like that because it's the distances is great, much shorter if you can go through the Arctic to get from Asia to Europe than compared to going through the Panama Canal to get to the same destination. So there's a lot of opportunities in the future as the ice levels continue to shrink. You get more reliable open water and you'll see more shipping in the Arctic. And lots of things to think about So, some examples. Top right is our Inuvik runway. That dip kind of showed up over a weekend, Saturday, Sunday. You cannot operate an airport with that type of dip in it, so we closed the runway and undertook an emergency repair. And are still trying to figure out exactly what's happening, what's underneath the ground there, and figure out what the most effective solution for that may be. On the left at the top is an old abandoned section of highway, it's old Highway 4, Ingham Trail. There's a big new corner there which we cut into the rock, but this is the old subgrade. You can see if you don't do any maintenance, just let the road go, this is the type of thing that can happen. On the bottom, picture there is actually Highway 3. This, even though we have maintenance, you can see what happens. And the road itself, we're actually undertaking the repair, fixing those areas of subsidence in the road. So that's okay, but you can see what's happened with the guardrail that it's. And then the photo on the far right is the Dempster Highway. You have a, this is near the Yukon border. You've got a thaw slump area there that kind of slowly every year creeps into the into our road grade, and obviously the road has been adjusted a little bit over the years, but every year we'll have to go in and do maintenance for that. I don't know if Steve, you're going to talk about these things or not, but it's an interest for scientists, all these thaw slumps that are in the Beaufort region. Just very quickly, these are our graphs, Fort Providence Ice Crossing. So we now have a bridge at this ice crossing, so we don't have to worry about this anymore, but you can see over the years, over the 50 or so years that we operated this, we constructed an ice bridge in the wintertime in Fort Providence on what was happening. So the regression going from an average opening of that ice crossing of beginning of December till the end of December, so we were losing almost a month over those 50 years for the ice crossing. That was one of the other thing that was happening was just the variability. You can see that it's relatively, the variability on the graph isn't too much in the first 20 or 30 years, but the extremes of when it opens and when it closes are much greater in the last 15 or 20 years that we were constructing that. Closing the ice road is the other graph there. Didn't change nearly as much. It's really because we put a lot more effort in constructing the ice bridge, and so those efforts, would pay off by being able to extend that closing of. This is our Mackenzie Valley Winter Road, and again, relatively stable, average of 75 day a year operation for that winter road up until late 90s, and then we obviously had a big challenge with that, the opening window of the ice road. Beginning in 2000, we started a program to construct permanent bridges on the winter road. So the weak link on this winter road is the ice crossings. The crossings is mostly an overland road, but you have to cross rivers, stream crossings, and so they were the weak link on it, so we started bridging those with permanent infrastructure. We're essentially done, I think we're 37 of 40 bridges on that road, and you can see what happened. We've actually improved this level of service that we provided on the winter road in the last 10 years or so. But again, expensive proposition. So some adaptation efforts, and I'll just move very quickly here. So on our winter roads and ice bridges, and the top box shows the problems that we're having. So here's what we're doing about it. Obviously, lots of increased effort to construct ice roads. Ice bridges in particular, where we have spray ice technologies, like a snow machine, except we're making ice instead of snow. We do that. You get lighter equipment under the road quicker so that you can clear the snow off. Snow would insulate the road and limit ice growth. We can clear that off and get the frost into the ice a little bit more. Using a lot of GPR, or ground penetrating radar, new technology, so we can measure the ice, test it a lot better, have a lot more certainty, increase our safety as we go out and do that. Talked about constructing permanent bridges. Also constructing all-weather roads. So we're, Inuvik-Tuck Highway is under construction right now. It is replacing an ice bridge. Tlecho All-Season Road, a road to Wati, is going to replace the first section of that winter road into the Tlecho region. And then a program to replace bridges, our ice bridges and ferries. Of course, Nature Bridge at Fort Providence is one of one of the drivers for that project was climate change and the uncertainty of being able to construct that. There's some pictures of the bridges at the bottom two are the on the McKenzie Valley Winter Road, some of the bridges that we have on the Winter Road. In terms of all weather roads, of course, increased maintenance repair, particularly on Highway 3 to Vetchco, it's the most expensive section of road that we have. Most challenges too. Increased maintenance efforts, snow removal, sand and salt, mowing. We need to incorporate climate change into our design for roads, and our Nivantuck Highway is a great example of that, where we had to, with the design of the road itself, we needed to build in our best guess about what's going to happen with climate change over the next 40 years and incorporate that into the design. We do have a number of different test sections, some on Highway 3 between Vetchco and Yellowknife, and a lot of testing on our Nivantuck Highway, in fact, around permafrost. Is there a better way to construct infrastructure or construct culverts so that we can stabilize the permafrost there a little better? And then we've also increased our emergency plans. We have a number of temporary bridges that are scattered throughout the highway system so that if we do have a culvert failure, we can respond relatively quickly and do it. Airports, again, similar to all weather roads, an airport is really just a runway, and in any event, it's just a very short section of all weather road. So we need to incorporate that into our design. Where we do have problem sections, because it tends to be shorter, we can put more intensive effort into it, and so we've done that by actually putting insulation underneath some of the runways and doing a lot of research to try to understand what's in fact happened there. And then, again, increased maintenance efforts. On ferries and marine, with variable water level, particularly low water level, there's lots of requests for dredging, expand service, so we're kind of working that, particularly in the Hay River Harbor. It's a combination of variable water level and then just the fact that the river itself is continually been silting up the harbor. So it's not all just climate change. And the bottom, of course, take advantage of shipping through the Arctic, but you have to then consider, you have to have appropriate spill response, you have to have appropriate monitoring mechanisms, you have to have lots of things to consider about if shipping is going to be taking place through that pristine environment, and one where any type of spill would have very significant effects. Nivantuck Highway, I talked about that we are kind of treating that as a research project, that there is a lot of different things happening on there, from a permafrost, from a monitoring permafrost, and then try to mitigate or adapt, sorry, to the impact that road would have, and hopefully improve its performance over time. It is constructed over continuous permafrost. The design itself is incorporated the permafrost into the design. Typical with a road, you would cut and fill, so you take off the hills and put them into the valleys. But we don't do that at all. But there's no cutting at all with this road. It's just all filling up. And the idea is that you put enough granular over top of the road so that the frost moves into the subgrade, into the new road that you've constructed, and that's where you get the stability for the road embankment itself. We, of course, 40 years out, who knows what the weather's going to be. The plan is that after 40 years that frost is still drawn into the road grade. So we've got lots of monitoring of that, thermistors installed throughout to check and see where that frost line is. All of the bridge structures will rely on the piles to be frozen and stay frozen, so we're monitoring those as well. We have a couple of different test sections in the far left hand there. We actually, instead of putting one large diameter culvert pipe, we're putting a series of small diameter plastic pipes, see if that will help protect the permafrost that's underneath. And then, so lots of thermistors and CO2 flux monitoring. As permafrost degrades, it releases carbon dioxide, and if you monitor that, you can see how much permafrost degradation you actually get. The scientist in the room will explain that a little bit more than I can. So lots of different things happening on the Nivantuck Highway. We want to make sure all that available information is available to researchers. They can take a look at it and learn from it as well, and tell us and others how to construct infrastructure, manage infrastructure. there's a, you know, a lot of other scientists, research community that's interested in what's happening here, and they've got their own things happening around the Inuvik. So conclusion, very quickly, of course, it impacts all types of our transportation infrastructure, impacting reliability and safety, adding time, cost, and complexity to the operation. Monitoring will help us measure performance, and of course, collaboration. We're not unique in this. There are other northern jurisdictions that have the same issues. And so there's lots of collaboration that occurs as well. Understand the problem and help address the solution a little bit. That's it for me. I assume we're going to Steve. And you'll
maybe we can take just
sure,
a couple
whatever
questions.
You like. Yep.
Any kind of questions for Russell or here?
It's not a question, but it's a kudos that I don't think I've really heard mentioned here a lot. One of the adaptations that I think you guys do extremely well is your use of social media. And I don't think we always see that as an adaptation. As someone who has to drive out of Yellowknife occasionally during a forest year, knowing that your Twitter account, your Facebook account, I think there's really, really fast things so that you're always letting us know what's going on. And I just want to say thank you for that adaptation.
Appreciate that, and you're right. And it's that forest fire, the one 3 years, 3 summers ago, that caused us to get much more proactive with it, and we've been maintaining it ever since. It's a very good way to communicate.
So is that a two-way street? So, like, if something's on the road, do you tweet out, hey, there's a problem, or so that you can both share information each way through social media? Like, do you hear about problems on the road?
Yes, people will tell us. We'll monitor anything that comes to us and be able to respond. Yeah.
It's probably quite a lag, though, because there's not a lot of connectivity.
Well, yeah, we're further out, but people tend to get to us if there's a problem. Yeah, right. They know how to.
For myself here, can you give us an idea of how much you're actually spending yearly on these adaptation and upkeep? Is that sensitive information?
No, it wouldn't be sensitive information, and I'll give you a guesstimate.
Okay.
So a typical highway in the south, a gravel highway in the south, would cost between $5,000 to $10,000 a kilometer to maintain. This section of road between Mexico and Yellowknife is $15,000 to $20,000 a kilometer that it costs us to maintain. So that's the annual cost. So it doubles the cost. And then, you know, kind of in Inuvik Highway and capital cost, it's kind of hard to quantify, but that was, you know, it's 140 kilometers and $300 million project for a two-lane gravel highway with a 70-kilometer-an-hour speed at the end of it. It's a very expensive way to construct the road.
So how would those budgets compare to some other, like, I guess my question is, is transportation really one more, do a lot of expenses come out of that department just to kind of maintain the infrastructure? The big one for
yep. The territory. Well, from a climate change perspective and impact, it probably is one of the bigger ones because we are, you know, everything we do is on land and impact. Public Works and Services, now part of the Department of Infrastructure, they're also very interested in climate change. They have to incorporate that into the foundations that they have on all their buildings. And then communities, all the communities, of course, and their impacts. Their infrastructure, it's on the ground, they got roads to deal with as well, and buildings, so they have to deal with the same thing.
We did a study showing that the impact on just permafrost on all public infrastructure in the NWT is in the order of $1.3 billion of lost life.
So is there evidence that, like, there's a cost that's just associated dealing with the building on permafrost, but is there evidence that would suggest that those costs are increasing because of climate change?
I'd say yes, because there's a process within government, a forced growth process, where if we have something changing that's causing us to have cost increases that's beyond our control, we can go through that process. And we have gone through that and used climate change as one of the reasons for on precipitation and on temperature, and needing to put more effort into maintaining the easy to track the increased use of sand and salt, for example, and that has gone up over the years. In part, just providing better service for people and expectations, public expectations, safety. That's one of the drivers, but the other driver is climate.
Thanks. Thank you. So I don't know exactly what Russ was going to talk about. I tried to steer away from ITH, R&D type stuff, but I think what I'm going to talk about is fairly linked, and the approach I've tried to take is a little bit different. So my name is Steve Kogal. I'm a permafrost scientist. I know most of you, but not all of you. And I've worked up here for probably 20 years. Permafrost was pretty slow business 25 years ago, but it's a hot topic now. So I'm a busy guy. What I want to talk about is, I'm going to talk a little bit, I know you got an overview from Kumari about permafrost and climate change, but I'm going to touch on that just very briefly as a precursor. I'm going to give a bunch of examples of how environmental change or climate change is impacting infrastructure, but also impacting the environment, because that's the context within which, of course, we maintain our infrastructure in our communities. And try to really impart this idea that we need not only to study the road, but we need to study the environment that the road is built in, because that ultimately is going to it's going to provide insight to the engineers and to the maintenance operators and so forth about how to handle issues. I'm going to talk a little bit about managing and accessing all of that information, and then the themes I'm going to focus on is how does science, which may seem esoteric in some regards, help. So I'll try to draw that link between the science and the infrastructure, talk about challenges, and then we'll talk about some opportunities. So I'll try to run that theme throughout the presentation. So you likely saw a map like this, which is a permafrost map of Canada. Canada is a permafrost country. Permafrost is simply ground that remains below zero for multiple years. So most of the NWT is within the zone of permafrost. Permafrost can vary with respect to temperature, to the distribution, the proportion of the land that's underlain by permafrost, but also the physical properties. So permafrost is defined by temperature, but it derives its significance from an infrastructure perspective based on the properties of what's underneath. So it's what's inside that counts. So as scientists, we try to understand that variability, and we present it hopefully in such a way that it's useful to society, but also to folks that are designing and planning infrastructure. So I'm going to just step into this region, which is the Western Arctic. It's the area where Russ talked about a little bit in terms of the construction of the Inuktitut Road. We can see this is a bit of a dated map, but the take-home message is that the climate is warming. That's not a surprise. And some of the hot spots are within the Northwest Territories. So, is permafrost responding to warming air temperature? It is. Permafrost is essentially the ground or geological manifestation of the climate. So where it's cold, you have permafrost. Where it's warm, you have less permafrost or warmer permafrost. And we are able to look at a map from here from the 1970s, which was compiled by Dr. Mackay, and it shows the ground temperatures on average in the Mackenzie Delta region. And we can see by returning to those locations 30 years later that the ground has warmed significantly. One of the interesting things about permafrost, as the ground temperatures get closer to zero, the rate of warming starts to slow down, because it takes a lot of energy to pull out of the ground to actually change ice to water. So temperature in warm permafrost doesn't seem to really be doing much until it's gone. Because as I said, you can warm up cold permafrost quickly, but as the permafrost gets warmer, it warms up more slowly because you're starting to convert ice to water. So one of the things we want to know is what are the consequences of the warming? And as I mentioned, the manifestation of that is the ice in the ground. So this is just a short video. It's a little odd because it's actually me talking in the background. It just provides an example of a phenomenon that is becoming more and more common in Western Arctic Canada.
In July 2015, a small lake in the Peel Plateau region of Canada's Northwest Territories drained because a large permafrost loss undergoed its shoreline. A small pond remains in the drained lake basin, and a cavity visible in the foreground developed when the lake poured its waters into the expanding thaw zone over a period of less than a few hours. This thaw zone has grown over time as ice-rich permafrost underlying the landscape has thawed. Initially, stream erosion exposed ice-rich sediments. Initially, has chewed its way through this landscape, displacing hundreds of thousands of tons of previously frozen materials downslope into the stream valley. What we observe here is consistent with a regional pattern of increasing disturbance and ice which previously glaciated landscapes, which are common throughout the Canadian Western Arctic. It is thought that these permafrost disturbances are increasing due to the intensification of summer rainfall in conjunction with a warming climate. The thawed slurry of debris has flowed and infilled the small stream valley. The debris has blocked the small stream, diverting its flow and eroding the far bank, causing new crosslumps to develop on the undisturbed slopes. Shrubs, grasses, and other plants have colonized nutrient-rich stable surfaces of the disturbance. Note the helicopter below for scale. This debris tongue extends almost a kilometer down valley. Research has shown this type of permafrost disturbance can significantly affect downstream water quality and ecosystems by increasing sediment and dissolved materials in the lakes and streams, and by altering aquatic habitat. Knowledge of the dynamic nature of permafrost terrain is necessary to inform planning and adaptation strategies in a warming circumpolar world, and to anticipate ecosystem responses a changing climate.
So that's just an example of some of the changes that we're starting to see. And what we actually did recently is we were able to map the distribution of these types of disturbances in northwestern Canada. And this was the map that we were able to produce. And what it revealed to us is that actually these very, very dynamic landscapes actually are bounded by the maximum extents of the Laurentide ice sheet. And we inferred from that that there's actually a lot of relict ice preserved in permafrost because these would have been deposited by the ice sheet, buried by debris, and then preserved in permafrost over time. So these are really dynamic landscapes. So this gives us a really broad picture of sensitive terrain. So these types of things can happen in permafrost, but not everywhere, and there's a geological explanation for those patterns. So this map here is not going to tell you where to build the road or not to build the road, but it gives you a general sense of the types of things that you would expect in different settings. Now, one of the challenges is that permafrost is becoming very dynamic. It's actually a misnomer now. How do we actually track those changes that are happening all over the place to varying degrees? And the science community is able to lean on things like remote sensing, which can image landscapes, can provide us with lots of information, to be able to track change. So this technological development is actually a huge advance in terms of being able to look at change. Now taking these landscape processes, these are also affecting directly infrastructure. And Russ actually pointed this location out, which is the Dempster Highway, where we had a thaw slump that developed adjacent to the road. It was infill, and then subsequently the materials that were displaced downslope, and we've had a sort of a whole series of a cascade of effects. But really, fundamentally, these disturbances are affecting the landscape, they're affecting roads, and thinking through how to actually mitigate these and come up with more elegant engineering solutions is actually something we really need to be thinking about. This isn't going to happen less frequently, this is going to happen more frequently. So we are taking opportunities to work with DOT to engage scientists into thinking about this and to think about some of the potential engineering solutions for these types of problems. This imagery itself is actually taken from a drone, and it's actually a surface model. So that is actually a digital elevation model that you're seeing. So we can resurvey these very, very quickly with these drones and look at displacements that you wouldn't even be able to really catch just by a site visit. And again, the analytical techniques and the potential that for looking at this data and inferring movement, slow movement, is actually pretty incredible in terms of how quickly that technology is advancing and becoming accessible to us. So another change that we're seeing is with climate warming is an increase in the active layer thickness, and that's that top layer of soil that thaws and refreezes every year. One of the consequences of that, particularly in areas of continuous permafrost, is that it takes longer for that active layer to refreeze. And what that means is that in many environments in the north, the landscape, even though it appears to be refrozen in the middle of winter, water is continually conveyed just beneath the surface of the ground. And this is actually posing significant problems to road infrastructure and also in communities Inuvik is an example. Talked to construction folks there, and they say there's an underground river in Inuvik. There's not an underground river in Inuvik. There's just an active layer that doesn't refreeze anymore, and water is conveyed through those materials. Now, there's no southern analog, because in the south, if you get a fall rain, the water will infiltrate, the ground will refreeze, and that water will just go into the groundwater system. But where we have continuous permafrost, that water is perched up close to the surface, and it's a problem if you're excavating in January, it's minus 30, and you're a meter below the ground surface, and you have water flow. It creates this sort of, I don't say it's an unforeseen problem, but it's a problem that we just are not really sure how we're going to deal with. One of the manifestations of this with respect to road infrastructure is illustrated in this video, which is play. And it's just a culvert. There's a little drainage moving through here. This is in November. You can see water starts to flow. And just watch what happens to the willows here on the side. As the water continues to come, you can start seeing the willows are starting to bounce up. The whole riparian zone is actually being jacked up. So the ground is starting to refreeze, and water continues to come, and it's lifting the entire riparian zone and then dropping it back down. Yes?
Quick question, what was the time lapse for that? Was it a year or?
Well, that was a couple days. So the water basically buoyed up the entire riparian zone and then dropped it back down in like three camera frames, so like in 12 hours. And of course, sometimes this stuff, this material is frozen into the culvert and it will damage the culvert, and these things can happen very, very quickly. One of the places where this is also becoming apparent is in bridge structures, particularly built in continuous permafrost. The bridge structures, because there is water that's continually conveyed through these streams now through the winter, like these very small streams, the bridge structures are actually doing kind of what they're supposed to do. They're enhancing freezing under the road embankment. The pilings are staying nice and cold, but you're actually creating a freeze dam. And water start to stack up behind these bridge structures and create icing such as this, which is, again, it's kind of a little bit of an unforeseen problem. But it's probably going to be just a challenge. Like dealing with water in the winter is, I guess, is that sort of unforeseen challenge. Another process that's occurring is associated with warming. We have greening. We have tundra greening, which you might have heard about. Most engineers couldn't actually care less about tundra greening. However, it does have some implications. When you increase shrub cover, you increase snow accumulation. And shrubs love to grow where there's disturbances. So when we map, this is a map that some colleagues from the Canada Center for Remote Sensing and an ecology prof at UVic produced, and it shows greening in the tough coastlands. It happens to be an area where the local community members are making these observations. Tundra's shrubbier, and we're also seeing it in satellite imagery. Now, shrubs really take off in old disturbances, and these red dots are actually an old drilling pads from the 1970s, and you can see that these places where the oil and gas industry went in and disturbed the ground surface when they were developing their operations have proliferated with tall shrubs. And in some cases, the permafrost is actually used as a waste containment medium for sumps. They're great places for shrubs to take off and grow. Aesthetically, this seems like a really good thing because nature is taking back the land. But from a snow accumulation perspective, it's actually very negative because these tall shrubs become magnets for snow. And if you pile snow up on the permafrost, you can't pull heat out of the ground and the ground warms up. So you have this feedback where you're growing vegetation, you're enhancing vegetation growth, you're enhancing snow cover, and you're warming the ground up, in addition to what warming would or is occurring due to climate change. So, again, a lot of these sumps and these drill pads, they were stable, but they were disturbed. Shrubs proliferate, permafrost warms up. A few of the oil and gas companies in the early 2000s went back to these sites and were actually quite surprised when they were looking at ground temperatures at the locations that they wanted to build production facilities at. Permafrost temperatures at these sites were several degrees warmer than everywhere else. And of course, this also can extend to road infrastructure. This is a picture of the Dempster Highway, and you can see the proliferation of tall shrubs adjacent to the road, and that's sort of a feedback. The shrubs like slightly moister conditions. They like the road dust because it provides nutrients to the soil, And the ground temperatures adjacent to the road are much warmer than elsewhere. So it's not the road itself, but the conditions around the road are being affected, which could conceivably affect the integrity of the infrastructure. So the other, I think the other, one of the other big bottlenecks that we're experiencing here in with all of this is that we have to make sense of all of this information that's out there. And managing and maintaining this information wasn't a priority necessarily 20 years ago. The GNWT itself actually generates a lot of very, very valuable information. And in the context of infrastructure, whenever infrastructure is constructed, there's often geotechnical investigation and often ground temperature information that's collected. The deliverable is usually the infrastructure, and that is sort of the focus. But I think increasingly we're starting to recognize that the legacy of that information and the value of it is immense going forward. So one of the things that we're working on as a government and with academic partners and different departments is to actually develop a system by which we can archive this information and make it publicly available, but in digital format. And that's not a trivial task. It requires energy and it requires effort and commitment. So it is a opportunity and a challenge. I think stepping back, I've talked about a lot of different scientific investigations, and I've kind of distilled them into like little sound bites or snapshots. The fact of the matter is, there's a lot of big science that's happening in the North. Everyone's interested in the North. And the question, and even as a scientist, I find it challenging to keep track of everything and figure out why we should care about a lot of this. I don't have a solution for this, but all you folks here, I believe, are Northerners. And I guess this is a message that I would provide, is to demand that this big science is accountable and is trying to make a connection and help answer the problems that you have, or your agency has, or the group that you represent has. And that probably is a policy related thing, but it's also just having a vision of what you want to know and being able to have access to these groups. So I'm not going to ramble on about that anymore, but it is an issue I think we have to deal with. So to wrap up, the take home messages from, I guess, Russell's talk and my talk is that this is all pretty complicated. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of change happening. Science can contribute to an information base. And if we have a good information base, we should be able to, it should improve our ability to make good decisions, or at least informed decisions. I think the reality is we need to expect surprises, but the better the information base, the smaller the surprises will be. Okay. I think we need to be a part of the science that's being conducted up here, and if we can be a part of it, and if these consortiums and groups can take a bottom-up approach, not a top-down approach, we can be a part of that process. We can understand what the science is being done for, and hopefully, we can apply it. And that involves developing relationships, I think, with the people that are doing a lot of this work. That's a good thing. And then I think that requires capacity in all our respective organizations to be able to make those connections. But also, I think we need a bit of a lever, carrot or a stick, to make these groups that are well supported to do this work to kind of come down to the North and understand what our problems are. So I'm going to wrap up there.